Hello and welcome to In the Court of the Wenton King. We're doing the next Genesis album, which is
The Landlord is Down on Broadway.
The Landlord is Down on Broadway. There it is. Terrible cover, sadly. Most of the covers are excellent. This one isn't. It's a good time to say though, this is my favourite Genesis album. And to me, prepare yourselves. Prepare yourself. To me, this is on a par with The Wall. This is as good as The Wall for me.
I wouldn't go that far. I would say this paves the way for The Wall. It lays the groundwork for The Wall.
That's interesting.
To occur. There is definitely parallels between the two albums, and this came first. But I think the main issue is I can't put it on that because I just don't understand it, Kev. I mean, what is
what The Landlord is Down on Broadway about? What is it about? Yeah. Well, I don't know. Nobody knows, so I'm afraid we're going to have to ask Hector.
Hector the Prog God.
Hector the Prog God, we're going to ask him. Are you ready? Have you got the instrument of Prog?
You're going to have to play the Prog God
the
notes.
The instrument of God. Are you ready?
Call of Duty.
Here we go.
I am Hector the Prog God. What do you want, puny mortal?
Hello, Hector. We'd like to know what The Lamb Lies Down on Broadway is about.
How can you not know something so easy, puny human? The Lamb Lies Down on Broadway. The Lamb Lies Down on Broadway is one of those albums that every prog disciple should know about. Oh, you make me so angry. I think I'm gonna...
No, no prog god. No prog god. Don't take your anger out on us. God, what's happened? What's he done?
Kev, you've angered Hector the prog god.
Well, at least he didn't kill us. So it's okay.
Yeah, yeah. I do feel I'll know a little bit more about The Lamb Lies Down on Broadway now, though.
Yeah, I mean, I think this is quite profound. I've got a better understanding. The whole pinata thing and the pink hippo business.
Yeah, Hector really knows his stuff.
Yep. Yeah, so obviously as this is a double album, this is going to be spread over two episodes. So this week we're just going to do the songs. We may do some analysis, but
along
basically next week, you may need to skip to next week if you want to see the full analysis before the songs. See you then. So, it's a big album. It's a 100-minute concept album.
You've already drawn a parallel with The Wall. It's obviously, it's quite melancholic. The humour is quite absent. It is there in parts.
Yeah, it's much more bleak. Isn't it?
Yeah.
It, right from the start, you see a change. And the pastoral, lush sound of previous albums is absent.
Yeah.
First song.
The Lamb Lies Down on Broadway.
Yeah, you've got the tinkling piano at the start, and straight away you hear a change. What's significant about this one is it's a rock song. Genesis do rock sometimes, but only occasionally. I think it's Mike Rutherford's influence when they have a good riff and things like that. That's a Mike Rutherford riff. We know Peter Gabriel didn't write The Light Lies Down on Broadway, which suggests that melody might be Mike Rutherford's, maybe, I don't know. I think the later versions are better, unfortunately, in terms of the band, when they got really good at playing it. Fast and intense. It got really good. Obviously, Phil was never going to sing it right. His vocals are too soft, so it misses Peter's intense graveliness, which is a shame. The best of both worlds is the one on the archive box set with the overdubbed vocals that's live. But yeah, strange song in a way, but at the same time, relatively straight ahead for Genesis.
It does sort of lay down the marker. We sort of said the Battle of Epping Forest was Peter Gabriel's worst because it was so wordy.
Yeah.
And you know, difficult to get your head around. This is a much more complicated idea than the Battle of Epping Forest, and equally as wordy.
Yeah.
It's not really the sort of lyrical style. It's not like typical poetry. It's more like long form poetry. So it's a very distinct story because it's so hard to get into. You have to know what the story is to get what you need out of it. Because as it doesn't really work on its own as just a musical piece. It's not something you're going to sit there and say, I'm just going to listen to the music on it.
No, you listen to the vocals as well, yeah. Not necessarily the words. You listen to the sounds of the vocals, don't you? And obviously the sounds of those vocals have a meaning.
Well, yeah, it's without that. If you don't have that meaning, though, I don't see how you could possibly enjoy this. If you don't understand what the album's about...
Well, but then the album is about a lot of things, isn't it? It's open to interpretation. I mean, the lamb... Is a William Blake poem, isn't it? Yeah, apparently it's a William Blake poem. It's about England's rolling hills and lush valleys and all that stuff. So it sounds like to me The Lamb Lies Down on Broadway is, you know, the moving away from the Genesis thing into something more real. And that's Peter Gabriel's journey and Rail's journey. But it's a lot of things as well. You can certainly read that into the title.
Many people would get that on the first listen.
No.
And I don't know if, without that kind of cue, how enjoyable the album's going to be like.
Yeah, I mean, it was mentioned on the that Danny Baker programme that was nicked off our idea. They mentioned this, and Danny Baker's response was, well, that's a bit of a difficult album. And it is, I suppose. It's just I know it so well, I only just remember that.
I mean, my impression of it is, I mean, we're sort of going back to the album now, is it's the kind of album you listen to when you've got sick of listening to everything else, and then you suddenly...
You need more stimulation.
Yeah.
Well, yeah.
And you sort of, then it kind of makes sense, in the sense that there's a bit of a puzzle to solve there.
Yeah.
And you've got the time. There's nothing to distract you to take you away from that, because you need to spend a lot of time,
yeah,
I would imagine, deciphering this.
So the second song,
Fly on a Windshield.
It's difficult to review this on its own. I think this and Broadway Melody of 1974 kind of have to go together. You can talk about Fly on a Windshield really is the little vocal introduction, just introducing what's about to happen. Something's happening in New York, and there's some sort of black cloud coming to suck everyone in, and nobody notices except for Rail. And then you've got this interesting guitar solo, which is a little bit not very Hackett-like, in that he's quite disarmed about it. He's using the harmonic sounds of the guitar rather than the notes, I think, and that's unique. But it's at that point between the quiet bit and the loud bit is a Genesis moment of awesome, which is when the keyboards kick in. It's awesome. It's fantastic. Even on the dodgy production on this album, it still sounds fantastic.
Yeah, it's kind of strange to have such a high point on track two, because it is definitely a high point.
Yeah, it really is. And I put Broadway Melody of 1974 with that as well. Really good new type of lyrics. Not something Gabriel's done before, and I think it works fantastically well. References to all these entertainment names, but they're all doing, there's I think there's a name of a murderer, and it talks about, you know, the cheerleader waves a cyanide wand, smell of peach almond, bitter almond. But he knows in a scent you can bottle all you made. And Ku Klux Klan sell hot soul food. So there's this sort of, what he's saying is it's New York, but it's an alternative reality. And I think that's a reference to something else on Selling England, on Dancing with the Moon at Night, when it's going on about young man says you are what you eat, old man says you are what you wear, messed up, like it's an alternative. And I think he's making a point about this isn't quite reality, but we're moving into reality now, and about, you know, the past being replaced by new stuff. But it just sounds brilliant. It's not really the meaning of the words, it's the sounds of the words. Smiling at the majorette smoking Winston cigarettes.
Track four.
Cuckoo Cocoon. Conversely, I don't know why this is even on here. I think, you know, you've had such a strong intro. Cuckoo Cocoon is kind of forgettable. It's a very average Genesis piece of music that could have been on any of the albums. It could have been on Trespass. But I don't think it's as good as any of those. It's kind of forgettable. I've noticed often when these things have been played, they've left that bit out. They've played this whole sequence without Cuckoo Cocoon, like in the reunion in 1982.
It did sound very White Album. Oh, it doesn't sound like a White Album again. It sounds like a White Album title, definitely.
It does, doesn't it? Yeah, Rocky Raccoon, Cuckoo Cocoon.
Yeah.
Obviously, it's part of him telling his story, obviously, about being... At this point, he's comfortable being in a cocoon. He's trapped inside, but he hasn't realised that yet. He's just comfortable, like, you know.
Track five
is in the cage. This is a whole different thing. This was what I picked up on the very first time I heard it. I thought, that's ace. It's one of these rare things where Genesis are really doing something really intense. Very popular song. I was listening to the Reunion in 82. There isn't a proper recording of Reunion in 82 that's been released. I think there is one, but it's never got out. And when it started, when it kicked in, not the quiet bit, but when it really kicked in, the vocals, there was a weird effect on his vocals or something, like it was going shh. That was the audience singing along, you know, and these are not simple lyrics, and it's all, you know, and that's amazing. But the album version is the weakest version, I think. Maybe that's controversial, I don't know. He got Brian Eno to come in and put his voice through a one of his synthesizers, and I think that's why they couldn't save it on the remaster. I think he wasn't happy with his own vocal performance as well.
Mm.
And the live versions are far better. The overdubbed live version is far and away better. But strangely, unlike Lamo's Down on Broadway, Phil is really suited to singing it. It's brilliant when he does it. And they did it for years and years and years, and it was the highlight of the show, right into the dreary pop stuff. It was part of the old medley, and very, very intense it got.
Wow. It is generally said that this is a really good song.
Well, yeah.
This is the one, you know, you go for. So I was kind of looking forward to this when it came on. And obviously my first listen was on 2008 Remaster, which it didn't kind of live up to my expectations of what a really good Genesis song was like. Mm. Obviously I really, really liked Selling England by the Pound.
Yeah.
And I was expecting that quality, or even Supper's Ready quality, surpass it. And I don't think it's that good. It's an integral part to the album and to the story on the album.
Yeah.
It's very important, and it is one of the stronger songs, but it doesn't stand out as much as I expected it to.
Mm.
Considering the songs leading up to that point, I think, like, you got Cuckoo Cocoon, you expect like a massive gulf of quality. Now, I suspect you probably think that there is a massive gulf in quality there.
Yeah.
I don't hear it yet.
Interesting, yeah. But I've heard 15 live versions, which are all better than the album version. Mm-hmm. So, you know, the album version just doesn't do it justice.
I would actually say the album is practically unlistenable.
Mm. It's got really that, like the White Album, it's got that horrible cold sound to it. It's just horrible.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, so In the Cage is awesome.
Mm.
Just remember that. Because we're going on to track 6 now.
Yeah. I'm assuming that's the second... This is the start of the second side. There's a nice little tiny instrumental, kind of typically Genesis, but it's interesting in that it's that keyboard sound. It's a very Genesis-y keyboard sound, but it's how it just affects different. On here, it's Rolling Hills. And on here, it's sci-fi industry and stuff like that. It's interesting how they can change... Just maybe it's the lyrics... Mm-hmm. Have changed the effect of the music like that. Sadly, you can't hear that little Seagun live one because of the audience after In the Cage.
The Grand Parade of Lifeless Packaging.
Yeah, and this is the real hint for me about what he's getting at. Rail has got out of the cage to what's happening outside, and he's found, or he thinks he's got out of the cage. You know, it's about commercialism and the loss of the simple old life and all that. And in that sense, I think this is about the same thing that Dancing with the Moon at Night is about, ultimately. Again, he got Brian Eno to put effects on his voice, and it sounds horrible on the album. But live, it's brilliant. And I think that could have been a single, I think. Not as it was on the album, but actually that song could have been a single. Probably should have been a single.
Yeah, I quite like this one. I think there's something about it feels a lot more distinct. Not distinct, clear. You can listen to it and you can sort of follow what's going on, and it's not sort of
convoluted.
No.
Yeah.
Although the imagery he's using is quite dark again. Because I sort of associate it with the sort of the lifeless packages of like lifeless bodies almost.
Yeah.
Bodies without soul sort of thing.
Yeah, I think that's
Which I thought was intriguing, you know, that sort of thing doesn't really normally grab me, but for some reason it added a layer. I could see there was a layer beyond the words that I could scratch, you know, I could scratch the surface and I could start to see it, whereas the rest of the albums, because it's so dense, you can't really scratch at the surface.
Yeah, this song stands on its own as a song with meaning, right.
So you can actually get into it a little bit on the first or maybe the second listening, you can sort of start to peel away.
Yeah.
Yeah, at the subject.
Next one.
Back in NYC.
This, to me, I think a lot of the music is written by the band, I'm assuming, and certainly that little bit arpeggio thing going on, that sounds like...
King Crimson? It does to me. I thought King Crimson shot. For some reason, Adrian Belew comes straight into my brain when I heard that.
Because I think it's very, very Peter Gabriel. The whole vocal thing, definitely Peter Gabriel, first three albums. And, it was only this song, I think, only this song and The Lamb were the only songs he ever played solo. The only Genesis songs he ever played live again, except for the reunion. and it's good in that style. So if you like the first three Peter Gabriel albums, you'll probably like Back in New York City.
I like Back in New York City.
I think there were some complaints from fans about the overdubbed vocals on this one, because it's quite a different style. As he was in 1999, he didn't do the real Gabriel kind of shouty, and he does a bit of that on that. So maybe the album version is better in this case.
Track A,
Headless Heart. This is a little respite. A lot of these instrumentals were to give his voice a break, because I tell you what, it is a demanding thing to get through, to sing all of that every night. And then the musical box at the end of it as well was quite a thing. So although he was designed that, it comes at exactly the right moment, and it is, to a certain extent, a traditional Genesis piece. And this could have been on Selling England or Trick of the Tail. So that's really nice to have that in there. And, you know, it's the Steve Hackett thing again.
Yes, very nice indeed. Because in the next track,
Counting Out Time, written 100% by Peter Gabriel, allegedly. It's the only Genesis song written 100% by Peter Gabriel, and it is very much single material. I think he's called it a pop song himself, and it's all right.
I tell you what I like about it: humour. Yes, there's some humour about it.
Yeah, it is like the sequel to I Know What I Like, isn't it? And maybe people would have seen it like that if it was. I don't know if it was the single, but it should have been.
It sort of it lifts the tone a little bit, because it is quite heavy going.
Yeah,
but I mean, if that could have been the single, I think the next track was probably, you know.
It's very, very popular, Carpet Crawlers. Also known as The Carpet Crawl. I wonder if that was an abridged single version or something, I don't know. Very strange they called it that. But yeah, Carpet Crawlers, the whole vocal melody and the lyrics are written by Peter Gabriel, we know that. It's about the people climbing the ladder. People climbing the ladder.
The greasy pole.
Yeah, you got to get in to get out. To get out of this nightmare,
you got
to play the game. So they're climbing up to the Chamber of 32 Doors. But don't care about that, because it's a lovely melody. Obviously, it went down well, very, very well live, because it's sing-alongable.
Yeah.
It's nice. Like a lot of Genesis, it's nice and pastoral. And Peter Gabriel was very proud of it. And there was a 99 version of it, an actual fully re-recorded Carpet Crawlers 1990.
It's a bit of a strange... Because of the story aspect, because on the archive, on the live version, he sort of gives you a little brief to what the story is about.
Yes.
Carpet with a porcupine, cuddling a porcupine.
Porcupine. Yeah.
Okay. You got issues, dude.
But yeah, it's very, as you say, that little chorus is quite sing-alongable.
Yeah.
So it has that sort of immediacy that, you know.
And actually, it's a great example of Peter and Phil vocals working very, very well together. With Phil quite low in the mix, because Phil is a fantastic backing vocalist. People forget that he's very, very good at doing backing vocalists and not being out front and shouty kind of guy. And Carpet Crawls, that's one of the reasons it's so good, particularly live.
Track 11,
The Chamber of 32 Doors. We come to the end of the album, and it doesn't end on a big shaman or anything like that. I think that's kind of cool. It's a melancholy middle movement kind of thing. It's very wordy, though. You know, I said I could sing the whole of Supper's Ready, including the keyboard stuff. That's true. I wasn't joking. I used to be able to sing the whole of The Lamb. But I can't anymore. I'll tell you what, I can do the first side, but get to the Chamber of 32 Doors, not a chance. Because but I like the melancholy of it. And the album ends bleakly like that. Yeah, just like The Wall, really. Although The Wall has a whole load of... before it gets there.
You're waiting for a whiz bang at some point, and you're for it all to come to a head. I'm hoping it happens on the second half of the album. Again, the most appealing thing about this song to me is the sort of concept, the idea that he's trapped in this room with 32 doors, only one of which will let him not go back inside to where he's been, the Chamber of Horrors that he's been to. And that is probably the one thing that's going to sort of get me into listen again. But again, you need to understand that concept.
It has to be familiar before you can,
And that's, well, I mean, it's true with all the Genesis albums, you need to sort of listen a few times to get it going. I think you need to listen more than a few times to this to really...
Yeah,
for it to really hook you.
So catch us next week for the other half of the Lamb, and catch us midweek for In the Court of the Winter Knave, which mini 5-minute look at Zappa stuff. See you then. Give us some likes. Thank you.
Yes, and please subscribe if you haven't and you feel like you want to.
Yes.